Fire, 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 whenever I press here. Okay. So that works. Now we just need to add a little bit of logic here. But before we do that, there is a slight problem because I don't think it's very, it doesn't gonna feel right if we just spray the play field with rockets like 60 times a second whenever we press fire. It's fine for input to just have it continuous whenever we press. So we're gonna do something to make sure that we only get one of these. And we can actually do that. So far we have only looked at the action ID parameter in on input and self, of course, but there is another one here that's called action that contains a little bit of interesting information. So let's print that and see what we get. Let's run and press. This is kind of weird. What is that? We get fire. You see that? Fire, and then we get a table. And then some sort of weird thing. Okay. Luckily, there is a function in Defold that allows us to print the contents of a table. We can use that. And that function is called pprint. The print prints the object. That level, pprint will open up that object and show what's inside. We can now restart that and then press. And we see that, okay, we get a couple of things. First, we get fire. Then this action object contains a value that's zero. It contains repeated, that in this case is false. Released is true. Pressed is false. If we go up, we see that the first time we press fire, value is one, repeated is true, released is false, pressed is true. Next time, pressed is false. So pressed is going to be true only once whenever we press a button. And we can use that information. So let's do that. Okay, so if action ID is hash fire, and action.pressed, then print fire. So if action.pressed is true, if this is true and action.pressed, if this is true, then this is going to happen. Otherwise, it's not going to happen. Let's keep fire and restart this and see. Now I get just one fire for each press, and even if I hold it, it won't fire again. And that is the behavior I want here. That's good. Next step is to spawn. Let us spawn a rocket. We do that by calling a function that is called factory.create. It takes a couple of parameters. The first one is the name of the component that is the factory. And we denote that component name by saying hash and then rocket factory, which was the name we gave it, right? Let's go back just quickly and verify that. We have main collection, we have player, rocket factory. Yeah, that was the name we used. So in the script, we do factory.create rocket factory. It also takes a number of other parameters. If we look here, we see that it takes a URL. I'm going to explain what that is later, which is the name of the component. A position, rotation, and some properties. A position, we need a position to start for it to start. And let's create one. Let's do local position should be get position. Let's take the position of the player. I wonder if I can do it like this. So it's a bit easier to see. So let's take the Let's spawn a rocket at the position of the player. Get the position of the player, factory create rocket factory with a specific position. That should probably do it, right? So let's, I'm gonna hot reload this right into the running game to try it. There you go. Whenever I press fire, it will spawn a rocket at the position I'm at. So that's a good start. But we see I can spawn like as many as I want here. But the next step is to add some sort of movement to these guys, I think. And how do we do that? Well, we do know how we created movement for the player. So why not use a similar method? Oops. Let's say that we use something like this. Take the position of the game object, modify it, and set it back. So let's do that for the rocket. And how do we do that? Looking at the rocket game object file, we see that there is nothing to give this game object any behavior at all. The only thing we do have is a sprite. So we need to create a script for the rocket. Let's do that. Click main, new, and script file. And call this rocket.script. And we get a new one of those. We have an init, we have a final. I don't think we're going to use final, right? No. Let's remove that. We're going to use update to set the position. Okay, so let's start by creating some values to use. We're going to need some sort of speed for this guy. Let's say that it moves at 200 units per second. We're also going to need a direction to move in. Let's do like this for now. Let's do a VMath vector just for testing, vector 3, and say that it's going to move to the right. So the X component should be 1 and nothing else so far. Okay, and in the update loop, the only thing we need to do now is to get the position, local post for position is geo get position. This is interesting. What should we type here? Because do we have a name for this game object? We probably do somewhere, but I haven't seen it yet. Because we haven't placed it anywhere. This is placed automatically by the rocket factory. And there is nothing in the, if I select this, it doesn't say anything about the name. So the game engine is going to give it an identifier, but we don't have it right now. Luckily, what we can do, we can actually omit the name here. What happens if we omit the name is that it will take the position of the current game object. We don't have to type anything if we are working with a current game object, which is fine here. So let's just skip the name in there and update the position. Position is position plus self direction times speed times delta t, delta time. And then geo.set position and position. And again, we can skip the name here. We don't need it because the engine will infer that if we don't have anything typed here, it will infer that this is valid for the current game object. And save it. So I think that's it. And now we can go back to the rocket game object and we also need to add that script as a component to the game object. Otherwise, nothing will happen. Right-click game object, rocket.geo file, add component from file, and select rocket.script. So now we have a game object with both the sprite and the script. And hopefully this will work as intended. So let's try it. Let's run. Okay, I can move still, and yeah, it flies off. But it only fires in one direction, right? Because direction, we set that to a set value. And there is the rocket doesn't spin. It's always pointing in the same direction. So there are a couple of things to fix here to make this a little bit nicer.